In the present session, I'll explain how we can perform read as well as write operations with respect to cache. So, cache is nothing but an important component that enhances the I/O performance in an intelligent storage system. So, cache is, say, semiconductor memory where data is placed temporarily in order to reduce the time required to service I/O request from the host. So suppose if I am considering a single host here and I am having one main memory. So the size of the main memory is large. Suppose the host is trying to access the data from the main memory. So this is main memory. It takes longer time. So in order to avoid that, I can consider a single cache structure. Within that, I can copy a part of the main memory. So that the host can access the cache directly and it can perform the read or write operations very quickly. Cache improves storage system performance by isolating host from the mechanical delays associated with physical disks, which are the slowest components of an intelligent storage system. So I can say that the physical disk, physical disk are the slowest components in an intelligent storage system. So here we can observe that the cache structure consisting of data store, tag RAM as well as the pages. Cache is organized into pages or slots, which is the smallest unit of cache. So this page size will be variable depending upon the application's I/O size. The cache consisting of the data store as well as tag RAM. So each entry in tag RAM indicates where the data is found in cache and where the data belongs on the disk. Tag RAM includes a single bit called as dirty bit, which indicates whether the data in the cache has been committed to the disk or not. It also contains some additional information like time-based information, such as the time of the last access, which is used to identify cached information that has not been accessed for a longer period of time. So such pages can be freed up from the cache. That means the pages can be flushed from the cache into the disk. When a host issues a read request, the front-end controller accesses the tag RAM to determine whether the required data is available in the cache or not. If the requested data is found, that is called as cache hit or read hit. So at that instant, the data is directly sent to the host without any disk operations. In a sequential read request, a contiguous set of associated blocks is retrieved. Several other blocks that have not been requested by the host can be read from the disk and placed into the cache in advance. So during the occurrence of read miss, what we can do is the data from the physical disk can be copied into the cache so that the host can access the data directly from the cache. So next we'll take read hit. So here we can observe that we are having a host. So during step 1, host will send a request, that is read request, and the requested pages are available within the cache. So cache consisting of the pages which were requested by the host. So that instant cache will transmit the data directly into the host. So that is called as read hit. So successful read operation, that is also called as read hit, the requested data is found in the cache. So data is not found in cache, so that means read miss. So initially the host will request, that means it will send read request into the cache, but the requested pages is not found within the cache. So at that instant the cache will send the read request into the physical disk. So now the disk will transmit the data into the cache, and after that the data will be transmitted into the host. So that means the host is not allowed to access the physical disk directly. Instead of that, data will be copied into the cache first. After that, the data can be transmitted into the host. So that is called as read miss. So we'll take write operations with respect to cache. Write operations with cache provides performance advantages over writing directly to the disk. So as I mentioned, the size of the cache is small compared with the main memory. Suppose if I am performing write operations with respect to cache, it takes a lesser amount of time instead of performing the write operations with respect to the main memory. When an IO is written to cache and acknowledged, it is completed in far or less time from the host perspective than it would take to write directly to the disk. So instead of directly writing into the disk, it takes longer time comparatively if you are writing the data into the cache. So here the write operations can be implemented using two methodologies. The first one is write back cache and the second one is write through cache. So in the case of write back, what we are doing is initially the data is placed in the cache and an acknowledgement is sent to the host immediately. So I'll consider one host and I'll consider one small structure. So this is cache and I'll consider the secondary storage here. So this is secondary storage or disk I'll take. So in the case of write back cache, what happens is initially the host will write the data into the cache. So it will write the data into the cache. So now after that, immediately cache will send an acknowledgement. So that is, I'll take it as ACK into the host. So now after sending an acknowledgement, cache will write the data into the physical disk. After that, it will write the data into the physical disk. So here the next methodology is write through cache. So in the case of write through cache, what we are doing is, so the host will send the data which is to be written into the cache. So cache will send the data into the disk, and after completing the successive write operations into the disk, the disk will send an acknowledgement to the cache and cache will send an acknowledgement to the host. So that is nothing but in the case of write through cache, it is continuous process. So initially the host will send the data in order to write the informations into the disk. So through the cache, so it will transmit the data directly into the disk. It will receive an acknowledgement. After that, it will send an acknowledgement into the host. Cache can be bypassed under certain conditions such as very large size write IO. So next we'll take cache implementations. So it can be implemented as dedicated cache or global cache. So in the case of dedicated cache, so we have to maintain separate sets of memory locations, separate sets of memory locations in order to perform read as well as write operations. So we'll maintain separate set of memory locations or addresses in order to perform read as well as write operations. But in the case of global cache, whatever the data, whatever the available memory addresses are present, so those addresses can be used in order to perform read as well as write operations. So next we'll take cache management. So in the case of cache management, so we can consider two different algorithms like LRU, so that is called as least recently used algorithm, and the second one is MRU algorithm, that is most recently used algorithm. So in the case of least recently used algorithm, that continuously monitors data access in cache and identifies the cache pages that have not been accessed for longer time. So that means some set of pages within the cache are not recently used. So the cache in such instance, with respect to LRU, this algorithm decides that such set of pages will not be accessed in future. So those set of pages will be transferred from the cache into the disk. So that means, so we have to free up, suppose that whenever the cache is full, so we have to delete some set of pages from the cache. So depending upon less frequently used concept, less frequently used pages can be deleted from the cache. Deleting in the sense, such pages will be copied into the disk. So the second algorithm is most recently used algorithm. So in the case of most recently used algorithm, here it's reverse of LRU. In the case of MRU, the pages that have been accessed most recently, that means those set of pages are already accessed many times by the host. Such set of pages will not be accessed in future. So depending upon that concept, some set of pages from the cache will be deleted. So that is how we can manage the cache space whenever the cache is full. Either we can adopt least recently used algorithm which continuously monitors data access in cache and identifies the cache pages that have not been accessed for a longer time. So in the case of most recently used algorithm, so this algorithm, with respect to this algorithm, the pages that have been accessed most recently by considering those set of pages are already accessed n number of times, so that such pages can be deleted from the cache. So now we'll consider the next concept called as flushing. So what is the meaning of flushing? Flushing is a process of committing data from the cache to the disk. So we have to commit the data from the cache into the disk. On the basis of I/O access rate and pattern, high and low level watermarks are set in cache to manage the flushing process. So I'll consider some levels or cache utilization levels. So with respect to that, we can flush or we can copy the number of pages from the or number data from the cache into the disk. So now I'll take two levels, like high watermark level as well as low watermark level. So high watermark level is a cache utilization level at which the storage system starts high speed flushing of the cache data. So the storage system starts high speed flushing of cached data. So in the case of low watermark level is a point at which the storage system stops the high speed or forced flushing and return to the ideal flush behavior. So now we are having three different techniques by which we can copy the data from the cache into the disk. So first we'll take ideal flushing. So in the case of ideal flushing, the cache utilization level is located between high and low watermark level. So cache utilization level will be between high and low watermark level. So next we'll take high watermark flushing. So high watermark flushing is activated whenever the cache utilization level hits the high watermark level. Whenever the cache utilization level hits high watermark level. High watermark level. So the last one is forced flushing. So it can be considered or activated whenever the cache is 100% full. So whenever the cache is 100% full, so forcibly we have to copy the number of pages from the few set of pages from the cache into the disk. So these three are the major flushing concepts. So the first one is ideal flushing, which occurs whenever the cache utilization level is between high and low watermark level. So the second one is high watermark flushing. It can be activated whenever the cache utilization level hits the high watermark level. So the last one is forced flushing. It can be considered whenever the cache utilization level reaches to 100% of its capacity. So in the diagram, we can observe that the ideal flushing, so cache utilization level is between high as well as low watermark level. So second one is high watermark flushing. So it can be considered whenever it hits the high cache utilization level hits the high watermark level. So the forced flushing can be considered whenever cache is 100% full. So by that time, the data need to be forcibly copied from the cache into the disk. So next we'll take cache data protection. So like RAID concept, here also we are using mirroring in order to protect the data. So each write to cache is held in two different memory locations on two independent memory cards. In the event of a cache failure, the write data will be safe in the mirrored location and can be committed to the disk. So I'll adapt the concept of mirroring. During the occurrence of any cache failure, the data can be recovered from the mirrored cache data. So next we'll take cache vaulting. The storage vendors use a set of physical disks in order to dump the contents of the cache during power failure. So suppose there is an occurrence of power failure, at that instant the cache data will be copied into one physical disk. So here within the disk, it consisting of whatever the data is present within the cache. So this is called as cache vaulting. The storage vendors use a set of physical disks to dump the contents of cache during power failure. So this is called as cache vaulting, and this physical disk is called as vault drives. When the power is restored, whenever the data at that instant, data can be copied from the physical disk into the cache again. So next we'll take backend. The backend provides an interface between the cache as well as the physical disk. It consisting of two components like backend ports as well as backend controller. The backend controller transfers the data between cache as well as physical disk. So the last component in the intelligent storage system is physical disk. The physical disks are connected to the backend storage controller and provide persistent data storage. So in the physical disk, we can store the data permanently. Modern intelligent storage systems provides support to a variety of disk drives with different speeds and types, such as FC, SATA, SAS, and flash drives. They also supports the use of mixed flash, mix of flash, FC or SATA within the same array. So, as I explained before, we are having, with respect to the intelligent storage system, we are having the major components like front-end controller, cache, back-end, as well as the physical disk. The front-end controller consisting of front-end port as well as front-end, the next part is cache, so which is located between the front-end as well as the back-end. So after the cache, in the intelligent storage system, the backend comes. So in the backend, we are having the backend port as well as backend controller, and the last component is physical disk. So these physical disks are connected to the backend storage controller and provide the permanent storage of data. So here we can make use of different storage system suppose in order to get the variety of disk drive with a different speed as well as types.